Hello, my name is David Byers Brown. I'm a lecturer here at the University of Kent. And for the past 15 years, I've been running two courses at postgraduate level. One is computer animation, the other is digital visual effects. I'd like to give you some idea about the sort of things we do and also who is suitable to do this kind of stuff. I've got some images here to do with modeling. Modeling is making objects in 3D programs. Fairly straightforward. I think everyone's come across it in some form or another. We take the animators and the digital visual effects artists and make them model to begin with. We've got various examples from student work here. Using professional 3D programs like Maya and Nuke, Photoshop, can produce really pretty great examples, though it does take you a lot longer than it would in a professional studio where they have more powerful machines and just more people involved in the process. You can see these examples here, all done on the course. Environments, characters, vehicles, all that kind of stuff, all possible here. Quite spectacular results. Take a very long time to do with our equipment, but that's fine. The ideal person to do this wants to spend their life more or less doing it, which is being an artist and getting paid, being a commercial artist. It's almost exactly the same as art, except, I mean, there's a big difference built up with saying that some people are fine artists and other people are commercial artists, but if you go back to the Renaissance, Leonardo was apprenticed to a studio which also painted walls, made chairs, pots. It was very industrial. A lot of artists have kind of commercial bylines. No different here. The big thing about this is if you're good enough and can get into it, which we hope to push you in the right direction of, you can buy a house, have a family, have a normal life, and concentrate on creating images, which is pretty satisfying. This is an example here, which is a polygonal model, which most things are. They're kind of points in space with lines between them in the 3D space. And you then texture them and render them in such a way, most of the time, to look real. Photorealism is a big thing in this area, and you can see from these examples just what that entails. A lot of detail and texture, and which is sufficient to, for instance, the example here, very nice, create an entirely artificial corridor and space. Totally convincing, big render times, but looks very nice. Here is this is a group project. We do group projects because industry loves group projects. They don't want people just working in their bedrooms. They want people to work together. Terrific textures on this creature. Obviously animated as well. Now, this is an example of a chap who was on our course. He's an alumni. He's done very well. He's worked on in London, sections of major, big budget feature films made, and he's worked on his Star Wars. And he is doing a specific job, and ultimately, it's about specific jobs. He's a texture artist. He's done the texture for this big spaceship, makes it look realistic. He didn't do the explosions, he didn't do the animation, but he did the costume on this guy. And that's the kind of thing you can aspire to get into, and you can get into. It's quite hard. You really have to be very good. But if you work hard and really concentrate on it, you can get there. Okay, so that's texture art. Now we just move on and get to visual effects. So visual effect simulation, destruction of buildings, explosions, smoke. Used in TV, film. Here we got characters being destroyed. There's another group project done this year. And we've got various different softwares. Yeah, liquid, simulated, smoke, long render times, quite fiddly to work out, but very satisfying to look at, interesting to do. These are all student examples, smoke from the car here. And we have students who've done really well in this area eventually. This is some examples from a chap we had a few years ago who specialized in simulation. He didn't do the whole thing, he did the simulation involved in this. He's now a CG supervisor on movies and TV in Canada. Animation, it's best to be a drawer if you're gonna be an animator, because drawing is the quickest way of thinking. This is a sequence of actions, animated, we call it animatic. And even simple bad drawings can be useful animation. If you do the computer animation course, you will do a certain amount of drawing, because it's really useful for, well, two things, modeling and movement. Very, very simple drawings can actually convey the idea of where things are going to go, how it's going to move. So we do have a certain amount of that. And nearly everything's planned like this as an animatic. Let's skip over this. Life drawing is terrific for animators because it suggests the post. We do life drawing, get live models in, draw them. It's sort of vital for convincing creatures and good physical action in the animation to do this kind of stuff. So animation that was to be planned originally with drawings breaking down, because you're always telling some kind of story, not necessarily true with visual effects. And then here, this little character is lovely. His little reaction is very nervous, he's being interviewed. It's using the animation to read real character into the computer model. And you see this guy's done lovely, lovely work there with these dinosaurs and done with our equipment. And you can do styles, different styles of animation, all essentially the same thing, different lighting techniques, some deliberate flatness in the animation. This is an old bit of drawn animation, which I did years ago. Drawn animation is great, but some of these scenes I animated all myself, did everything, but you can do it, you can make it look so much better these days, and that's where the demand is. This is a former student alumni, done very well. He's gone to New Zealand, I think they did some of this at Weta. Terrific work. Of course, this former student didn't build the models himself. He doesn't do they've got whole muscle systems that fit onto these characters, and then fur, moving fur, all that kind of stuff. But he provides the movement for the scenes. He's mainly specialized in creature work. If you saw this great World War film, there's some good monsters. And he's very good at it. He's now a super, he did just been a creature supervisor for a whole section of the Lion King. It's just about to come out in a minute, I think. But yeah, it's the same kind of stuff that you learn in animation, except you get to concentrate on parts of it, make it very much better in a professional environment. This is something that's essential to modern movies. The camera's nearly always moving. And in order to match the 3D asset you produce, which all the apes are there, with the live action, you need to recreate the space that the camera took in. And that's evolved quite a bit. I worked on Who Framed Roger Rabbit. It was hell trying to put these eyeballs, even in cartoony style, into this thing. We had these black and white reproductions of every frame of film, and we had to put little crosses on bits of dirt on the floor, try and work out how the parallax worked, work out how the perspective changed. It was really hard. Not that, well, it was okay for the time, but it wasn't that successful. But that's moved on quite a bit. It's pretty good in small soldiers, but we started to get humans to do it. Humans had to take the film and reconstruct the space. They used to get rostrum cameramen, guys who used to shoot animation, were all out of a job, so we used to get them to do it. But now we can do it in our own studio, get pretty good camera moves. See, these statues here aren't real. We've tracked this footage and produced that. Here's a lovely example from a Polish student. He built the whole building and textured it, put it into a National Geographic shot. Again, also very impressive. This case, guy has redesigned a square in Palestine very effectively, very nicely. He had a drone shot and added these assets. A digital visual effects job there. Terrific though, looks lovely. So here's another one. I think it's Margate. These buildings, most of the buildings in the background are fake and have been added by the, there's no funfair there. Looks completely convincing. So you can see the use of this stuff in television advertising is good. But one of the biggest areas that our students get into these days is compositing. That's sticking together the artificial or several different elements to create a something that looks like it was all shot by the same camera. Big part rotoscoping, tediously drawing around bits of footage, frame by frame, so you can combine them. You tend to use green screen if you can, but if you can't, like, here's an example of green screen, nicely using mats. It's very hard to get bits of hair. He's got taken combined two mats, and it works pretty good. Very big use in TV and film these days. Lovely. He's taken the whole... this is a Spanish student who's been working for a company called Milk for years and did this rather spectacular shot for his final project. It's a year-long course, so it's got taught mainly for... Both courses are mainly taught for about 6-7 months, and then you get to use what you've learned, anything else you know, and produce major pieces which hopefully will get you a job, or at least get your foot in the door. This is how he constructed the scene, made a NASA-type environment, taking various live-action elements and put them in, and put it all, this is our lab. We don't have a space station outside. This is a pond outside our building. Very effective creation of a boat, 3D model stuck in there. This kind of thing is used all the time in television. Game of Thrones is full of it. Mainly using Nuke, which is a compositing program. And lovely results. So just to get to the end, I hope I've given you some idea of the kind of things we do. So if you're interested, look into applying. I'm always willing to answer an email. Thank you.